conditions. Now we want to take the same geometry, and we want to exchange. We want to say, well, rather than saying that the boundary conditions are moving, we're going to say that the no-slip condition applies to the wall. We'll say that the walls are motionless. But now we're going to allow there to be a pressure gradient. So now I'm going to assume I have two plates. Again, these plates are parallel to the XZ plane. They're infinite in extent. I'm assuming that I have a flow that is steady and unidirectional. But now I'm going to allow there to be a pressure gradient. And for simplicity, I'm going to take this pressure gradient to only be in the X direction. I'm also going to say that these plates are motionless. Now, when I do this, I can go through a similar process of looking at the Navier-Stokes equations and identifying what simplifications I can do. And the only catch is that I'm not going to be able to simplify quite as much. So I said that this flow was steady, and that means that my unsteady term goes to zero. I said it was unidirectional, and when it's unidirectional, that means that the velocity vector and the velocity gradient tensor are orthogonal. Their dot product is zero. And that means that this is zero. But now I'm left with two terms. I can't just say that everything is zero. Now I have that these two things are equal to each other. Now physically what this means is that I have a pressure gradient that's pushing the flow around. And at steady state, there's a net volumetric viscous force that's balancing that out. And when I solve for this solution, I'm going to get a distribution that's going to show pretty clearly, I think, how I have a uniform force that's being generated by the pressure, and then a uniform volumetric viscous force that's canceling that out. So because I've said this pressure, in this case, is only in the x direction, I'll write this as dp dx. Again, I have a velocity vector that only has an x component, and it has gradients only in the y direction. And so this is now the simplified version of these two terms. This then leads me to a final governing equation that looks like this. Now, because I've said that this pressure gradient is uniform, this is now a constant. And again, I no longer have a partial differential equation. I have a constant here. I have derivatives in the y direction. And this means that I can again integrate this directly. Again, we've taken geometric structures. We put restrictions on the problem to make almost all of our mathematical problems go away so that we can use very simple techniques to come up with these solutions. So now I need to solve this equation. dp dx is equal to eta times d squared u dy squared. So again, this is a constant, which means that we can integrate this with respect to y in a relatively straightforward fashion. What this equation really says is that the concavity of this velocity distribution is equal to a constant. Unsurprisingly then, when I integrate this, I get a solution that basically says that my velocity vector is a second order polynomial. This is just a parabola. And if I apply the boundary conditions, being that the velocity is equal to 0 at y is equal to plus h, and the velocity is equal to 0 at y is equal to minus h, I get this expression. And if we draw what this looks like, I get a velocity distribution that looks like this. You can see that at both y equals h and y equals minus h, if I put those values in here, this term becomes 0 and my velocity becomes 0, consistent with the boundary conditions. You can see that the maximum velocity in this velocity distribution is where y is equal to 0, at which point we get minus 1 over 2 eta times dp dx times h squared. When we look at this distribution, we should be able to see the different terms of the Navier-Stokes equation. We neglected the unsteady term and we neglected the convective term, but we still have two different things going on. Anytime I have a little control volume, I have a pressure being applied to one end and a smaller pressure being applied, I have a smaller pressure being applied, but it's in the other direction. So because there's a pressure gradient, I have a large pressure being applied here and a small pressure being applied there. So there's a net pressure force. That net pressure force comes from the gradient P term in the equation. At the same time, when I look at these two different sides, the net effect of these two different sides of this control volume gives me a net viscous force. That pushes against this pressure force. And all of these forces are in equilibrium. So everywhere I look in this flow, I have pressure force pushing uniformly and a viscous force pushing back. In fact, if I wanted to graph out a spatial depiction of that net pressure force, that net pressure force is uniform. And similarly, if I wanted to graph out the net viscous force, that net viscous force is also uniform. Now, When you look at this solution, do you see little h in there? In what way does the size of this flow change the relation between a pressure gradient and the velocities that are observed? If I make h big, does the flow get fast or does the flow get slow? It makes it faster, right? I make h big. If I look at the center line where the velocity is at maximum, where y is equal to 0, I make h big, this velocity becomes big. If I make h small, the velocity becomes small. If I integrate this and I come up with the average velocity, you'll find that the average velocity is proportional to h squared. In fact, it's proportional to h squared everywhere. So there's a noticeable difference between the Couette flow and the Poiseuille flow. And that's that for the Couette flow, our mean velocity was not a function of h. For the Poiseuille flow, the mean velocity is proportional to h squared. And if I took the ratio of these things, if I took the average Couette flow velocity in a system like this, divided by the average Poiseuille velocity in a case like this, I would find that that ratio scales with h to the minus 2 power. Now, what does that tell you about systems when we make them smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller? Which sort of flow is going to dominate? The surface-driven flow or the pressure-driven flow? The surface-driven flow. Right? Now, the reason why this becomes important to us is because the electrokinetically driven flows, at least in microscale case or in microscale flows, are surface-driven flows. And that means as we take things and we make them smaller and smaller and smaller, we're going to stop paying attention to the pressure. We're going to become much, much more interested in capillary forces, which are surface forces, and electrokinetic forces, which in most cases end up being surface forces.